Hello, I have a 2009 Crown Victoria police car, and like everybody else, my gauges are acting funny. So I went to a junkyard pick your own parts, and I removed this gauge cluster from a wrecked police car, and when I put it in, everything was working except for the odometer, but the speedometer was reading about 20 miles an hour low, and I could see the needle needs to be moved, so I was going to move it to zero and start from there and maybe take it for a test drive and adjust it. But of course the plastic cover is on right now when I put it back together. So I have to take it apart again and remove that plastic cover and I'll leave it off and drive it without the plastic cover on. But I thought I'd videotape the process of removing the dash. Show you how pretty easy it really is. On some of the videos, they don't show you that there's a plastic panel here in front of your knees. And then there's one under the column here that has three bolts in it, three screws that need a 5.5 millimeter socket. And then it snaps together. This one take off first, then the lower steering column has three bolts in it, then the upper one just snaps off, and on the 2009 you don't have to take off the shifter or anything because there's this rubber boot around it. Then you pull off this strip, which I'll show you, to get to the four bolts here and two bolts here. This little panel's coming off, the light switch is coming out, and really that's all there is. Then this whole radio section comes out, all the way up to here is all one piece, and then there's four bolts to get this disconnected, and you just gotta take the slider off of the gauges. So it sounds like there's a lot to it, but there's three tools that you need: a 5.5 millimeter socket, a 7 millimeter socket, and a straight screwdriver that's just used for prying plastic. And mine was never apart, and this area right here was a little tight, but if you just wiggle a little bit, it comes out very easy. So I'm gonna get my socket ready and then I'll show you how easy it is. Okay, here's the only tools I'm gonna use is a 7 millimeter socket and wrench, flat screwdriver. This has a 5.5 millimeter socket on it and just a little extension so I can get up in the dash a little easier. This is a 2009 Crown Victoria, and I'm not sure about other models, but the 2009 has this is the brake release lever for the parking brake, and then right here is the brake release, and that is actually screwed on. There's the brake release, and there's one screw there that's a 7 millimeter So I'm going to take that one screw out, and that'll take this plastic panel off that's right in front of your knees. And under the steering column, there's three 5.5 millimeter bolts I'm going to take out. Those are the only 5.5 millimeter bolts. Other than that, everything else is the 7 millimeter. So I'm going to try to position this where you can see. Here's one 5.5 millimeter. Okay, it's on the floor. I'm not going to show you this whole thing, but the first time I did it, it only took me 20 minutes without knowing how to do it at all. And so now I've done it one time before. So I imagine it's going to take me 40 minutes this time. So that was those three under there, but I'm going to take this parking brake bolt off. Okay, this is the parking brake release. There's a seven millimeter small screw in here. And when you get that out, just pull it forward a little bit. And you can drop that away from the plastic. And then that's the only screw on this neat panel here, so that just pulls away. I'm trying to do it one-handed. And then under the steering column, that just, after those three bolts are off, that just pulls away from the top half. And then you just have to slide it off of the tilt steering wheel mechanism. I guess it's a little hard to see. And do one-handed. So then you want to just pull off the top of the top plastic off the top of the column. So now I have the panel off of front of your knees, under the steering column, and on top of the steering column. So that was three bolts here. One for the parking brake, holding that on. Okay, now we're gonna go after the main dash now. Found it was a little easier to open this door and just let the just to get a little more room on the end here. Throwing those in the back seat. You almost don't need a screwdriver, because once you get on the end, all you have to do is get at the end of it. And you can see how easy that comes off. When you pry outwards a little bit, it just disconnects. It's just got some snap clips. Behind here is a warning light indicator that you're still have your seatbelt on. There's a couple of, here's the heater controls. This is all one piece. And there's just some clips behind there. It just pulls off. And then this is the trunk release. The trunk release and that warning light, the seatbelt warning light. That's all one piece. So I'm gonna go ahead and undo this clip on the driver's side. There's a little pin on the side that you push in with a screwdriver, and then you can push the connector out. Try to show you that, but I don't have enough hands. And then on the other side of the column, it's the same deal, but this one's only a few inches long. You can just pull that out. That one has a couple of connectors in it. Trying to do it one-handed. When you get behind this, there's one, and there's two of the bolts you need to get to. Hold on a second. And this one, and mine, this outside connector has a little 90 degree turn on it. Maybe that's just bent. Yeah. Yeah, it just pulls off. These connectors here, these electrical plugs, you don't have to remove those because we now have access to the two bolts on this side, just with it hanging there. So that side's hanging there. And actually, it's the same case on this. You really don't have to remove these, the trunk switch, because you can get access to these four bolts. So it's four bolts on this side and two on that side. Okay, let me just show you where I'm at here. Just pulled this panel that starts over there on that side. Just pulled it off with my bare hand. I didn't use the screwdriver at all. And then I pulled off this side panel. It's exactly the same deal. Just let them both hang there because they clear the screws that you need to get to. And it's really no big deal getting that off. And I took the kick panel off, lower and upper column plastic. And one thing you're going to need to do is take this light switch out. So you just kind of get the screwdriver in underneath it, in the center. And then just by prying it back up, it'll pop right out without breaking it. Popped right out. So then now it's loose and you can just pull it out of there. Like I said, my dash is really tight. So there's two connectors here. You're gonna have to remove these two connectors. And this is typical of the connectors in the car, all of them. Like this one, there's a tab
that you would push in, push down on this tab, and then you can put the screwdriver underneath the tab, this, the plug, and pull it out. And then this one, you do the white one first, because this one's here, then the other one's on the side. You push the tab in on the side, and then pull, just push up with the screwdriver, and it'll pull that connector out. So I'm gonna do that, and with two hands. Okay, unplug the two plugs, and when you do that, the headlights come on. But you could unplug the battery, disconnect the negative cable to the battery before you start, but on newer cars, they have a transmission shifter interlock with the brake pedal, so your foot has to be on the brake pedal in order for the shifter to move out of this position. And later I'm going to want to move that gear selector down to get out of the way of the gauges coming out. That interlock between the brake pedal and the shifter is an electric switch. If you have a dead battery, you can't pull it out of gear. There is a release mechanism. It's a button that you would push in. I haven't quite figured it out yet, but it's under, well, it's under there. You would have to take the plastic off, and then you push in on that button and it releases the shifter to move the shifter out of gear when a battery's dead. But that's a story for another day. So I got these four bolts on this side and two on this side. I'm going to take out right now. Just take those bolts out. Okay, I took those bolts out. Now this piece with these, from these bolts up to the underside of here, is all one piece. This here, the vent is going to come out with it. The radio is going to come out with it. This vent's going to come out with it. There's no bolts here. There's holes there, but there's no bolts there. This is all coming out with one piece. This vent is going to come out, and this surround and down here. So you kind of have to pull on it a little bit. See, it's coming out. Okay, that's that side. And then here you can get in front of the plastic. And then this was the only sticking point on my car, right above the radio. It's all going to come out in one piece. Doing this all one-handed. Because it's really not that difficult. See, it popped out. It's okay now. So right now, I'm going to want to move the steering wheel down, the tilt down, and this whole thing slides forward. In order to get behind there, we're gonna up in the top corner of the radio, right in the front, right on the top is the antenna, and then on this side is the power connector, and on the driver's side of that, I can't really get my camera in there, on the driver's side there's a connector. As soon as I get it, the connector off, I'll show you how that power cable hooks up. Okay, I pulled the dash panel out a little farther and tilted it down so I can show you this switch. Some of the videos, they say, oh, just unplug this or that, and unless you know how these plugs work, they're kind of tricky. So going straight in, this is the back of the radio, and the antenna plug is here that just pulls straight out. This is the power connector and all the connectors for the speakers and everything. Try to get a little closer on this. On the driver's side, going straight in, There's like a slot for a screwdriver. Let me see if I can move my light. Of course, flashlight never ends up where you want it to be. This is the power connector on the back of the radio. And there's this slot for the screwdriver. And you have to push towards the passenger side. And of course it takes two hands. That'd be nice if it would stay there. Didn't show you anything. This is where the screwdriver went in. There's a little tab there. Right at the bottom where this, that gets pushed in towards the plug while you're pulling out. So it kind of takes two hands just to get that little plug out. Then once that plug is out, the whole dash is going to come out now. This whole piece will just, you can just pull it out, put it in the back seat, put the radio, the vents, and all that. Even it sounds like a big job, but really, it's just getting the kick panel column off, pulling this strip off by hand to get to, it's still connected. I just have to snap this back on, getting those four bolts. So you can get behind the radio, get that. And I'm already up to the gauge cluster here. So there's two bolts on this side, two bolts on this side. And then you take the plastic front off. So you can get to the slider here. There's a cable that goes to the actual gear shift knob. Lever. So I'm going to take these four bolts out. Of course, the light is never where you want it. There's one of them. There's another. There's the third one. There's the fourth one. Having more trouble with the flashlight and the camera than I am with the bolts. So I'll take those four bolts off. Once you get the radio unplugged and the antenna out, then that whole panel comes off. And one thing, vents. The two vents, three vents, and the radio are all on that one piece. So you throw that off. Now really, I'm only four bolts, two bolts on that side, one for the parking brake, and three under here. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 bolts. Screws. That gets us up to the removing the gauges. There's two on this side. There's two here to get to the gauges. That, then you can take off the front plastic cover, which is what I'm after right now. And then there's also a cable that goes from the shifter arm, a little cable up to the slider. That's connected, you don't want to break that. That's actually right here. There's a little wheel that will adjust it. And then a little cable that comes across to here. So you, once you get the plastic, once you get the front plastic off, then you can just separate that cable system from the gauges and pull the gauges out. I'm gonna unscrew those four bolts and get to the plastic. Okay, now I got the four bolts out of the gauge cluster. And you wanna tip it forward, and there's one connector on here, and again, this connector has a tab on the top that I just pushed in, and then this hook, try to get a better view of it, this hook pushes back, and it reveals the actual connector, and that kind of pulls out on a rotating type of motion. So that's the only connector for the gauges. Now, this is how the plastic front attaches to the gauges. There's three of these on the top and three of them on the bottom. You might want to use a screwdriver for this, but they go fairly quickly. So I just pulled off the top. Now there's three more on the bottom. Then I'm going to just tip the cluster forward, but it's still connected with that cable for the slider. I'm just going to reach in with my other hand and do those three same black clips on the bottom. But it takes two hands, so hold on. Okay, so I use both hands and I unclip the same three clips on the bottom. And then that just separates the front plastic cover from the gauge cluster. And you can pull that out of there. And I'll show you the next step. I'm just gonna put the camera down and grab that. Okay, so I just removed the plastic. You can kind of set the gauges back in there. And on each end of the slider, just right around this white thing is a little tab. You push it in and then pull out the little slider. There's one on the other side also. Try to get close, right sort of where there's a hole, and you can see the white in the back. There's a little tab that you can just push in, and it pushes towards the center, and that whole little slider mechanism just pulls away from the gauge cluster. But I'm not taking this cluster out. I'm just taking the plastic off so I can get to the speedometer needle. Now in my case, the speedometer was reading about 20 miles an hour under what it was going. And the speedometer hits a bottom here, right here. And it's not at zero. And I'm thinking that that's about how much it was off. So if you go all the way around to the top and you turn it past, you can hear it slipping on the shaft. So now I'm much closer to zero. I want to get it to zero, so I'm going to go a little more. That's the end of the stroke. So now I'm just over zero, so I can turn it back down to zero. Actually, when you're looking at it from out here, it looks zero. But when you're looking at it dead on, it's a hair under zero. I guess I'd rather it reading a little faster than I'm going. If my daughter's driving the car, then a little over what it shows. That's pretty good. It might be, depending on how you look at it, might be a tick over. But if I'm going 20 and it's showing me 21, that's not such a bad thing. Now that the needle is kind of zeroed, I'm gonna put the dash back together without the plastic on it. set my phone to a speedometer GPS based readout and compare my phone mile per hour to the actual car, and I'm thinking that it's going to be pretty close now that I move that needle. This is a junkyard gauge cluster, and unfortunately on this one the odometer doesn't work, but having this one in, I can drive the car while I send the original out to get fixed, and then when I swap back in my original one, possibly I could send this one in to get fixed and then maybe sell it on eBay, because I don't think I need two. I heard that Dorman Products is starting to make remanufactured gauge clusters. They do have, this is a 2009, they do have 2009 gauge clusters, but only for Mustangs at this point. Older cars, they do have Crown Victorias, I think up to 2005. Dorman, go on dormanproducts.com and type in, or just do a Google search for Dorman gauge instrument clusters, and then that'll lead you to which cars that they have gauge clusters for already. I imagine that they have a warranty, they're guaranteed to work. I would trust a Dorman product. Also, when you disconnect the headlights switch, the headlights go on, so even though the gauge is not, the dash is not together, I put the switch back in, because as soon as you unplug the switch, the headlights come on, plug it back in, and they go off. So, alright, so now I'm going to put the dash back together minus the plastic. So I'm just, this piece and this piece just snap back in. So I'm going to try that and take it for a drive. I don't need to put all this bolt back together. I'll let you know. Okay, now I got my phone connected. It's sitting where the radio was. I don't have the radio back in yet. And I just, you saw me adjust the speedometer. It was 20 miles an hour off before. So now I'm going down a short road to a stop sign. But it says just over 20. Where's my speedometer's not. Those red lights are from the gear selector. So it appears to be right on because I'm at 31. And that's just over 30. Now it says 33 on the digital. Red light coming up. It says 31. I'm just gonna go straight through this yellow. 33, 34, 35, 36 on the digital. Pretty close, eh? 35, 36. I'm showing 40, 39. Maybe at 1 mile an hour under. Pretty close. I think
if you were within that 36, 34, 33, I think if you were that close, the cop's not going to whipple over a mile or two. Unless you're going 103. 27, 30. So, I'm happy. I'm gonna go put the plastic back on. Between 30, 35 there. Maybe showing them 1 mile under. I'm gonna go put the plastic on. Okay, I'm back in my garage. That worked pretty good, resetting the speedometer dial down to zero. I can see when I pulled in my garage, it didn't quite settle down at zero. But I pushed it down, it seemed like it just faded back up. But anyway, I'm gonna go ahead and put the plastic on since the speedometer was pretty accurate with the GPS. Just had two other little comments. Was in the end of the stalk on the Crown Victorias, there's a overdrive on/off button. You can turn the overdrive off on the electronic transmission. That wiring goes down through the column as well, and there's typically a connector right here, and my wires, and it's pretty common for that wires going into that connector to break, and I was getting intermittent use out of that switch, which may or may not be impacting the current electricity in the gauges, but I noticed the wire was broken, so I just eliminated the connector and individually wired the bypass the connector and just twisted them together and taped them up individually and then together. So I've had no problems with the overdrive button after that. So I hear that's a pretty common problem. And the other comment was to a good tip would be to get a magnetized nut driver, 7mm magnetized nut driver, because when you're sticking those screws up in here, if one falls, then it's down here, it's inside the dash, it'd be a bit of a pain. So when the plastic is in front of the gauges, it's kind of far back to get to these screws, and a magnetized bit or nut driver would probably be really ideal for this particular job. But I'm just gonna put the pull that out. I only put two screws in it, and then put the plastic all back together and call it good. Okay, one last shot. Cut the dash all back together. Goes together very quickly. Four bolts there, four bolts there, two on the other side. Plug in the radio. Really, when you see some of these internet videos, they got wires everywhere, pieces all over, looks intimidating. Sometimes you work on your car, you're under the hood, you're under the car, jacking up shit. You know, it's raining out, whatever. This is one of the easiest ones, just sitting in the driver's seat the whole time. The speedometer's reading zero now. The odometer on this one doesn't work. I'm gonna get that fixed though. All right, thank you.